wanted to tell you that whatever you're going through, if you're a child of God, and somebody know what I'm talking about, you don't have to go through it by yourself. Come here, Bernard. Now, this is the way they used to sing it back in this old song. In shady green pasture. Anybody remember that old song? So rich.
So rich. And so sweet.
God leads.
God leads his children.
Right along.
He leads us along. Oh, yes, he does.
Where the waters,
where the waters could flow. Bates the weary ones feet. If you just let it go.
Can I get one witness in here tonight? Anybody know where they
come? Oh, 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 oh.
Now listen, listen, listen. I got the second verse says, sometimes
you'll be on the mind.
And the sun,
that's where the sun will shine so bright.
God leads us.
God leads his children. He leads them along. Yes, he does.
And then,
sometimes you might be in the valley. In the valley. It'll seem like it's the darkest night. But still in the midst of the darkness, if you trust and believe him, God will lead his children. He'll lead us along.
Yes.
Oh, yes, he will.
Now everybody did do something. That's why we say
some go through, yeah. Go through the fire.
I glanced back down at the police and autopsy reports, yellowed press clippings, and black and white crime scene photos on the table and took a deep breath. I lifted the top page from the stack, adjusted my glasses, and began reading. Years spent poring through countless reports just like these had enabled me to develop the ability to transform the facts and images appearing on these pieces of paper into a series of moving pictures, loosely resembling a movie. All I needed to do was absorb the information, and before I knew it, scenes and images were spilling out inside my head. The sensation was similar to watching TV, only most of what I glimpsed was much more violent. It all began on a frigid Tuesday morning around 7:50 a.m. The date was January 15th, 1974. That was the first moment the city of Wichita underwent a transformation because of what took place in a white house with black shutters in a lower middle class, predominantly white neighborhood in the southeast part of town. When the man responsible for the event fled the dwelling at 803 North Edgemore Street around noon, the residents sat quiet for over 3 hours. A furnace rumbled in the basement, and the family's German Shepherd paced anxiously throughout the snow in the backyard, letting out an occasional bark. Shortly after 3:30 p.m., 15-year-old Charlie Otero and his brother Danny, 14, and sister Carmen June, 13, walked home from school and discovered the bodies of their mother and father in their bedroom. Charlie tried calling for help from the kitchen wall phone, but he couldn't get a dial tone. So he ran to the house next door, shouting that his father was dead. A moment later, the neighbor sprinted back to the family's residence, ran down the hallway to the master bedroom, and poked his head inside. He spotted Julie Otero's body sprawled atop the bed. Nearby on the floor lay her husband, Joseph, with a butcher knife beside him and his bound ankles propped up on a briefcase. The neighbor had no idea that the knife was there because the Otero children had used it to cut the bindings off their father. So in a flash, he assumed the worst. Joseph had murdered his wife, then killed himself. That was what he told police a few minutes later when he telephoned them from his kitchen. By the time rookie Wichita Police Department patrolman Robert Bob Buller arrived at the Otero house less than 5 minutes later, the 3 or 4 inches of snow carpeting the lawn had begun turning to slush. Dispatch had radioed him that there was a possible murder-suicide at 803 North Edgemore. Charlie was on the front lawn when Buller pulled his cruiser up to the curb. The teary-eyed teen was desperately yanking on the arms of the ambulance crew who had arrived a few minutes before Buller. Charlie pleaded with the paramedics to go inside to see if they could revive his parents, but all they could do was apologize and explain that they had to wait for police to give them the okay. Buller made his way up the walkway, chatting with the ambulance crew for a few moments as Charlie sent his brother and sister off on a mission to fetch the two youngest members of the family. He believed they were on their way home from elementary school. Being the protective older brother he was, he didn't want them arriving back at the house and having to look at the bloody, swollen bodies of their parents. Buller entered the house and made his way into the master bedroom where he spotted the bodies of Joseph and Julie. He gently touched their skin with his fingertips, trying to gauge the temperature of their flesh. Their skin was cold, and their limbs were already stiff from rigor mortis. They'd been dead for many hours, he concluded. Joseph lay on his back on the floor. His feet, clad in white socks, were bound tightly together by rope at the ankles. Strips of cord, each tied in complex knots, lay next to the bodies. Charlie told the officers that he sliced the bindings off of his father after discovering him in the bedroom. Next to Joseph was a plastic bag that had been pulled off his head. Blood was smeared around his mouth and nose. His thick, strong hands were swollen to the size of baseball mitts. Julie's face was also grossly swollen, and dried blood was caked around her nose and mouth. Carmen June had used fingernail clippers to cut the gag out of her mother's mouth, along with her many bindings. The white nylon cord that had been snipped away from her body had formed a thin necklace-like bruise around her neck. She was barefoot and dressed in her powder blue house coat. Her ankles were still bound by a single loop of white cord. Sitting on a nearby dresser was a framed photo of a pensive, smiling Julie in her wedding gown. Most of the drawers had been pulled open, and it appeared someone had rifled through the contents. Additional officers arrived at the home, and before long, they discovered the body of Joey, the youngest of the Otero siblings. The boy, who wore maroon corduroy pants and a shirt covered with dragons, lay on his side on the floor of his bedroom beside the bunk bed he shared with his brother Danny. Next to his head was a Wichita phone book. His ankles were bound by cord. Another cord extended up behind his back and was knotted to his wrists. The cord had bound his hands behind his back, was cinched so tight that the boy's tiny wrists were bruised. Like those of his father, Joey's hands were engorged with blood and lymph and had swollen to several times their normal size. The manner in which he was bound suggested that the unidentified subject, remember that, unsub, either tied the boy himself or instructed another family member in how to do it, perhaps trying to create the impression that if everyone would just cooperate with him, he'd take what he needed from the house and be on his way. A few feet away from the bunk bed sat a wooden chair. The bottom rung of the chair had been broken. Splinters from the shattered piece of wood lay atop the carpet. I glanced at the crime scene photos and imagined the killer sitting there, watching the boy die. And somehow, the rung had snapped. The sick image of this killer having the wherewithal to watch Joey suffocate underscored the staggering amount of control he maintained over the Otero family and himself. The fact that there was so little evidence of a struggle meant two things to me. The first thought was that more than one offender might be involved in the murders, but this possibility had a couple of major flaws. To begin with, I'd never heard of a crime scene where two offenders had worked together in such perfect synchrony. I'd also never seen a case where two offenders would each have bondage as their signature. Normally, each killer would have its own distinct patterns at the crime scene. More often than not, one offender will be organized and controlling, whereas the other is disorganized, leaving evidence behind. Then there was the fact that the only biological evidence recovered at the scene was semen, later determined to have come from just one person. So if just one person was involved, I believed he must have relied on a gun, not a knife, to intimidate the members of the Otero family, who, according to police, were trained in karate. His gun was the equalizer. It leveled the playing field in a way a knife couldn't. But most disturbing of all about the scene was that Joey's head had been encased with a series of hoods, a white t-shirt, a white plastic bag, and a blue t-shirt. Back in 1979, when I initially looked at the case, the presence of the bags and shirt over the boy's head led me to believe that killing Joey was probably the most difficult murder the unsub committed that morning. The killer, I theorized, identified with the child. Looking at the young boy, he glimpsed himself. Lying there on the floor, Joey was helpless and hopeless, and in exactly the same way the killer felt helpless and hopeless in his own life. Within the mind of the killer, all the other murders were justified, but not Joey's. I thought that was why whoever had killed him had gone to such lengths to cover his face. He couldn't bear to look at it. In 1979, therefore, I advised the police that if they ever tracked down and were interviewing a suspect, they should provide him with a face-saving scenario, focusing only on the young boy, not the other three family members, telling him something I had written like, "We know you don't feel good about the death, not murder, of Joey. It was difficult for you, and you tried to soften the kill." Even though this might not be 100% true, what I wanted them to do was place the suspect at the crime. But now, 5 years later, I learned that the killer had also used hoods on Joey's father and mother. Unfortunately, the officer who briefed me on the case back in 1979 had somehow omitted this fact. This unintentional oversight reminded me of an adage that has long since become my mantra. Profilers are only as good as the information they receive. In other words, garbage in, garbage out. Shortly after Joey's body was discovered, bullets set off to search the remaining rooms in the house to determine if the killer or killers had left behind any other grisly discoveries. Because tornadoes are a fact of life in this part of the country, he knew there was a basement. He just needed to find a way to get down there. And as he walked down the hallway that led into the living room, he spied the contents of Julie's purse scattered atop the burnt orange shag carpet. Bulla glanced around the room at the wood carvings hanging from the wall that looked as though they'd been picked up on an overseas trip. A moment later, he spotted a door in the kitchen that led down to the basement. He opened it, but all he saw was blackness, so he had to rely on his flashlight while slowly navigating the carpeted stairs. Near the bottom step, he spotted a pair of shiny black boots that looked as though they might belong to a little girl. Walking slowly across the room, he spotted a squadron of model airplanes in various stages of construction spread out across a table, along with a rocking chair and TV set. In an adjacent corner, a door led to a small room containing the family's washer and dryer and a wall filled with wooden storage cabinets. Bulla walked through the doorway into the darkened room, but before he could locate a light switch, his shoulder bumped into something solid that gave way when he made contact with it. He stumbled back, aimed the white beam of his flashlight onto the object, and instantly jumped back in shock. What he had bumped into was the stiff body of Josephine. 11, dangling from a pipe. A noose, fashioned from the same type of cord used on the others, bit a deep hemorrhaged groove into her neck. Her hands were tightly tied behind her back. Her mouth had been gagged with a strip of towel that made her tongue bulge out above the top of the gag. It was swollen and the color of eggplant. Josie wore a pale blue t-shirt and nothing else. Her panties had been pulled down to her ankles just above her saggy royal blue socks. The back strap of her bra appeared to have been sliced with a knife. And around Josephine's body was wrapped a web of cord. This reinforced my belief that the unsub had arrived at the home with a large length of this cord in his murder kit. Like some Boy Scout gone bad, he'd come prepared. Her wrists were tied together behind her back and bound to a rope encircling her waist. Another length of cord had been wrapped around her knees, followed by yet another around her ankles. The tips of her toes almost touched the concrete floor. On her leg was a milky, gelatinous substance that appeared to be semen. It had run down her leg over her sock and formed a tiny puddle on the floor. Bulla took a deep breath, shook his head, and headed back upstairs. "We got another body in the basement," he announced to the officers and detectives who had just arrived at the scene and were busy combing through the house. I just got to pause for a few minutes. That's just a little bit too deep. Too heavy.
Every now and then, we like to go way back and pull out some old songs. Hallelujah. We're talking about spiritual warfare. We're talking about pulling down strongholds.
Before the discovery of Josie's body, the killings had all the makings of a revenge or retaliation style homicide, but now the case had taken a macabre, darker twist. It now seemed to reek of a homicide that had sexual underpinnings. This meant that police were dealing with a much, much more sinister, complex type of killer.
Every now and then, we like to go way back and pull out some old songs. Hallelujah. We're talking about spiritual warfare. We're talking about pulling down strongholds. But there was an old song that they used to sing years ago. There was an old song. But look like the enemy was trying to hinder when the devil was trying to bind. There was an old song that they used to sing. Hallelujah. Somebody would get a tambourine. Somebody had a washbowl. Somebody had a bass drum. Somebody had different kind of music. But they would get happy. They would look at the saints of God and say, "Help me drive on. Drive on, take it away. Help me drive on.
Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. Help me drive on. When the call about the Oteros came over his radio, Wichita Police Department Detective Bernie Drawatsky had been riding through the northeast part of town looking for a couple of suspected heroin dealers. Like Bulla, he knew only that there had been a report of a possible murder-suicide at 803 North Edgemoor. Upon arriving, he quickly learned that police had discovered four bodies, including two children. Drawatsky, who was also known as a cop's cop, didn't like what he was hearing. Over the years, he immersed himself in plenty of violent crimes. He solved grisly murders, survived bloody shootouts, taking down armed suspects using only his fist. But something about what was unfolding inside the Otero house felt deeply bizarre and disturbing. While all the detectives and crime scene technicians were moving through the house, Drawatsky, who would eventually arrive at the scenes of three other BTK murders over the next 3 years, fanned out across the neighborhood with several officers. They interviewed residents about anything they might have seen happen outside the Otero house that morning. Eventually, he located a witness who had caught a glimpse of the Otero family's tan-colored Oldsmobile Vista cruiser station wagon backing out of the garage at approximately 10:30 a.m. The driver, according to his neighbor, was a short man with a Middle Eastern complexion. Another neighbor also reported seeing a dark-haired stranger quickly back out of the family's driveway. Whoever was driving the car was in such a rush that yet another neighbor had to slam on his brakes to avoid plowing into him as the neighbor backed onto Murdoch Street. A few hours later, the car was located in the parking lot of Dillon's Grocery. A witness at the scene told police that the driver exiting the car looked terribly nervous. His whole body appeared to be shaking. It was hours past sunset when Charlie Stewart, the lead detective working the case, broke the news to the three surviving Otero children that their two younger siblings weren't going to be coming home from school. From 15-year-old Charlie Otero, Stewart, known for his rock-solid investigative skills, learned that the family had moved to Wichita in the fall of 1973 from the Panama Canal Zone, where Joseph, 38, had served the last stretch of his 20-year hitch in the Air Force. An aviation fanatic with a penchant for bongo playing and practical jokes, he decided to move his family to Wichita, known as the air capital of the world, in order to pursue a career in flying. For the past couple of months, Joseph, who had a commercial pilot's license, worked as a mechanic and flight instructor at a local airport. Like his wife, Julie, 34, to whom he'd been married for the past 16 years. Joseph was born in Puerto Rico. The couple's five kids, ages 9 through 15, were all well-mannered and studious and seemed to adore their parents. The only other member of the family was their often unpredictable German Shepherd mix, Lucky, a trained military guard dog the Oteros had brought with them when they moved from Panama. The dog was pacing around the backyard when police arrived, something that perplexed detectives when they spotted boot prints near the spot where the unsub had cut the family's phone line. Why, they wondered, hadn't the foul-tempered Lucky started barking to sound the alarm? After speaking with the distraught, dazed children, a picture of the family's morning routine began to come into focus, along with some rough details about what may have happened over the course of the morning. The kitchen appeared to hold the lion's share of the clues in explaining the opening moments of the attack. From the looks of things, the kids were in the midst of preparing their lunches when the killer or killers entered. The three older Otero siblings had already departed for school. Josephine had just finished fixing a sandwich that consisted of a smear of potted meat between two pieces of white bread. She wrapped it in wax paper and placed it in a lunchbox covered with flowers, left sitting on the stove. Joey stood at the kitchen table beside his father, spreading meat on a piece of bread. His open lunchbox, with pictures of policemen on it, sat on the table beside him. Joseph was hunched over the table, eating pears from an open can. Stewart and other detectives figured that it must have been just around this moment that Joseph asked one of the children to take out the garbage and place it in the trash can sitting back behind the house. Two theories emerged over what happened next. In the first scenario, Josie, who had finished with her lunch-making duties, pulled on her white mittens, grabbed the garbage pail, and walked out the back door. It was at this moment that the intruder grabbed her and forced her back into the kitchen, where he confronted the rest of the family. Police retrieved her mitten, which might have fallen off when she was jumped by the attacker, on the concrete stoop just outside the back door. In the second possible scenario, Joey was the one who dispatched on garbage duty. The fact that he hadn't finished making his lunch probably wouldn't have fazed his father, who had the reputation for being a taskmaster. Josie might have been giggling over the fact that her brother might not get to finish making his sandwich before heading off to school. So in the spirit of brotherly retaliation, Joey grabbed her gloves, lovingly caressed a trash bucket with them, and then headed outside, where he was quickly overtaken by the unsub. I'll be right back.
Talking about pulling down strongholds, but there was an old song that they used to sing years ago. There was an old song, but look like the enemy was trying to hinder, when the devil was trying to bind. There was an old song that they used to sing. Hallelujah. Somebody would get a tambourine. Somebody had a washbowl. Somebody had a bass drum. Somebody had different kind of music. But they would get happy. They would look at the saints of God and say, help me drive on. Drive on, take it away. Help me drive on.
All right, I'm back. Sorry about that. Okay, where was I? lost my space. Okay. Okay, so exactly what happened next also proved difficult for detectives to determine with any certainty, although a couple of facts seemed clear. It didn't appear that anything had been taken from the house, which ruled out the chance of the attacks being a botched burglary. It also didn't seem likely that this was the work of two intruders, and because the interior of the house didn't indicate that a struggle had taken place, it seemed unlikely that the killer entered the house brandishing only a knife. To maintain the kind of control that it appeared he must have had, he in all likelihood used a gun. The prevalence of ropes, medical tape, and other bindings signified to detectives that the killer had arrived prepared. Excuse me. Police speculated that after the attacker somehow managed to subdue the family and tie them up, he quickly decided to get rid of Joseph. With this one wild card out of the picture, the killer could continue his work in a more leisurely pace. Exactly what Joseph must have been thinking during those final moments, no one will ever know. But this one-time champion boxer, who was also a black belt in karate, surely must have been cursing himself for not putting up more of a fight when he had the chance before allowing himself to be tied up. Time was another factor. Even after he managed to kill Joseph, the unsub would have been constantly watching the clock. He knew he had to work quickly. With that many people living at the residence, the odds were good that somebody, one of the other Otero siblings, a classmate, another parent or neighbor, might show up at the house. Yet he still wanted to savor the sick thrill of what he was doing, reminding himself that he couldn't spend much time with Julie, Joseph, and Joey. He hadn't come for them. From what I could see, they were just appetizers. It seemed obvious that he'd been watching the family, and what he really longed for was the main course and the dessert, all rolled into one. 11-year-old Josephine. Judging from the abrasions on the upper portion of Julie's neck, just below her ears, she had been strangled from behind while she lay on her stomach. The killer had evidently straddled her, lifting her torso up off the bed while choking her. Beside her, traces of semen were found on the sheets and pillow. These were eventually determined to have come from her husband. The presence of Josephine's glasses in her parents' bedroom led detectives to believe that the killer had purposely left them there to confuse investigators. Another bit of evidence that puzzled detectives was the chair with a broken rung found in the boy's bedroom. In her interview with police, Carmen June claimed that the chair had come from the bedroom she shared with Josephine. Upon learning that, detectives began to suspect that the killer had moved the chair into the boy's bedroom and then held Josephine in his lap, forcing her to watch her brother suffocate. The wooden rung could have been cracked while he struggled to hold the squirming child, who probably would have fought to keep from watching Joey die. And even though traces of bruising could be seen encircling his neck, Joey was the only member of the family to die from asphyxiation, not strangulation. With a plastic bag over his head, along with the two t-shirts, the boy probably took 4 to 5 minutes to expire. The killer's decision to take Josie down into the basement indicated just how badly he wanted her and to what lengths he'd travel to act out the fantasies writhing inside his head. He no doubt knew that such a move would have been incredibly risky. He could have easily gotten trapped down there if someone had entered the house. Nevertheless, he was clearly eager to take the risk. The presence of the gag in her mouth provided another window into the mind of her killer. There was really no need to gag her because the others were all dead, and due to her location in the far corner of the basement, neighbors wouldn't be able to hear her scream. Nor was there any reason to hang her to a pipe or tie her up at all if all the suspect wanted to do was rape her. What he did was all about his need to script, direct, and produce a crime to fulfill his fantasies of dominance and control. She was no longer human, merely a prop. After binding her wrists, thighs, and ankles, he pushed her head through the loop in the rope hanging from a water pipe and pulled it tight, carefully to make sure it lifted her body just high enough so the tips of her toes barely touched the cold cement floor. And in order to prevent the rope from biting into her neck, she would have had to strain to push against the floor with all her strength. I wouldn't have been surprised if he had demanded that Josie talk dirty to him. But my guess was that she was too petrified to play along with this sick game. The one common theme I learned from interviews I conducted with sexual offenders was that they would script their victims, even if they were juveniles, and coerce them to talk in such a word in and coerce them to talk in such a way that it sounded as though they wanted to be sexually assaulted. Perhaps Josephine was so terrified and confused about the horrible events that had just unfolded in front of her that all she could do was whimper and plead for her life, and that was the last thing the killer wanted to hear. It ruined everything. He'd come to our house to live out a fantasy. There was no telling how long she fought to stay conscious. Her underwear had nearly been pulled down to her feet, just below the white rope he tied around her ankles. At some point during the ordeal, the killer tugged her blue t-shirt down over her left shoulder, then cut her bra strap with a knife. Before walking back upstairs and switching off the lights to leave Josephine hanging in the darkness, the unsub masturbated, ejaculating onto his victim's right leg. By the time police arrived at the scene, the semen had dripped onto the floor, forming a sickening, milky puddle. Within days of the killings, one of the city's two daily newspapers created a secret witness program, hoping to coax locals into phoning one of the paper's columnists to feed them tips on the case. The reward money donated by one of the newspapers for anyone who provided information that led to the killer's conviction eventually climbed to $7,500. Rumors about the case spread through the city like a flu virus. Not even the investigators working on the homicide were immune to all the tall tales. Some of the detectives were perplexed by the seemingly large amount of semen left on the floor in the Otero's basement. Exactly how much seminal fluid was present at the scene was never established due to the fact that it had begun to dry and spread out by the time Josie's body was discovered. If it could be proven that the volume was too great to have come from a single individual, it could help substantiate claims that more than one killer was involved. But first, detectives needed to determine just how much semen was discharged during a typical ejaculation. To do that, police reportedly approached a cash-strapped Wichita State University upperclassman with an overdue parking ticket and made him a proposition that involved an empty test tube. I was never able to determine what, if anything, the police learned as a result of their unusual offer. For police, the investigation that ensued over the next few weeks quickly became as convoluted and complex as those knots found in the Otero home. Nobody could remember a case quite like this. Over 1,000 neighbors, co-workers, ex-cons, and friends of the family were interviewed. The local newspapers and radio and TV stations carried reports of the killings and the latest developments in the case nonstop. The killer had forced his way into a home, into the one place where people always believed they were safe, then savagely murdered a husband and father, a wife and mother, along with their little boy and little girl. The aftershock of the murders proved disorienting to the city's collective soul, shaking loose everything Wichita stood for. In one brutal swoop, the unsub had managed to turn this law-abiding town upside down, causing nearly everyone to begin asking themselves, if he could do this to the Otero family, what would stop him from doing it to mine? Despite the presence of Josie hanging from a pipe in the basement, detectives just couldn't shake the idea that the murders had either been an act of retaliation or due to the families having just moved to the area from Panama was somehow connected with the narcotics trade. It also seemed possible that the killer had been targeting Julie and her daughter. If that were true, he was undoubtedly surprised to find Joseph at home on that morning, especially because there were no cars parked in the driveway. Little did the killer know that a few weeks earlier, two men had run Joseph off the road. The accident not only caved in the front end of his car, which was now in the shop, but also severely injured his shoulder. By early February, none of the leads unearthed by detectives had led anywhere. In an effort to dig up some information into Joseph Otero's background, an investigative trip to Puerto Rico and Panama was undertaken by Floyd Hannon, Wichita Chief of Police, and Bill Cornwell, Chief of Homicide. They traveled there to flesh out some of the rumors they heard about Joseph Otero. Could this veteran pilot have been involved in the drug trade? Might this have been a gang hit? Was it possible that the murders were a ritualistic killing performed by some religious group the family belonged to? Other than getting a suntan and having a few run-ins with the local police, who didn't like the no-nonsense attitude of these two gringo interlopers, Hannon and Cornwell did little to crack open any new leads. By the time the two cops returned to Wichita, they were no closer to solving the murders than they had been a month before, when the bodies of Joseph, Julie, Josie, and Joey Otero were discovered. That concludes chapter 3, and I've been reading for 52 minutes, and I think I will come back the wee hours of Thursday morning and read chapter 4 for you. Oh, it's getting even deeper, man. You know what? Let me think. See, the thing about it is I'm running out of time on this StreamYard thing. And so, yeah. Well, hold on. Let me play a song and think about it. Is that okay? I'll play a song and think about it. Let's see.
David, you know what?
I said play a song, not an ad. Come on, Ed.
Come on, where it's been. May have got your heart broken a few times in the past. Never last strong as it used to. It don't feel as good as it used to. Before, and all the things you used to say, things you used to do, went right out the door. Ooh, no more will you be the one. That's what you tell everyone around you. But you know they've heard it all before. What more can you say? Yeah. When love won't let you walk away, and you can't help who you love, and you find yourself giving it all away when you think you're enough. Ooh, I wanna be the one who you believe in your heart is from heaven. The piece of me who leaves when you're gone because you're sick from heaven. I wanna be the one who you believe in your heart is from heaven. And there's a piece of me who leaves when you're gone because you're sick from heaven. Now you can wait your whole life trying to change what they feel from what's been. You may have put your whole life into a mess, loving what you thought it could have been. I don't want to swing the chain and you don't feel as good as you used to. And everything you used to say, everything you used to do, went right out the door. Oh, no more will you be the one. That's what you tell everyone around you. But you know they've heard it all before. What more can you say? Yeah. When love won't let you walk away, it can't help who it lasts. And you find yourself giving it all away. I wanna be the one who you believe in your heart is sinking from heaven. There's a piece of me who leaves when you're gone because you're sinking from heaven. I wanna be the one who you believe in your heart is sinking from heaven. There's a piece of me who leaves when you're gone because you're sinking from heaven. Everybody say I wanna be the one you love. Everybody say I wanna be the one you trust. I wanna be. Everybody say I wanna be the one you need. I wanna be. Everybody say I wanna be the one. Oh, when you're gone because you're sick from heaven. I wanna be the one who you believe in your heart is sick from heaven. There's a piece of me who leaves when you're gone because you're sick from heaven. I wanna be the one who you believe in your heart is sick from heaven. There's a piece of me who leaves when you're gone because you're sick from heaven.
All right, here we go. I'm going to continue because I see there is one person who's been hanging with me. And you're just as important as 1,000 people. And so I am doing this just for you. Chapter 4. Oh, here we go. One down, three to go, I told myself, sliding the stack of crime reports from the Otero murders back to its original spot on the library table. Next up was a pile of papers containing every imaginable detail of the April 4th, 1974 murder of Kathy Bright, a 21-year-old assembly line worker at the Coleman Company. Owing to the fact that BTK had left behind an adult survivor who could possibly identify him, this was the one homicide for which he never directly claimed responsibility in his taunts to the media up to this point. It wasn't until almost 2 years after BTK's bombshell BTK's bombshell communique. No, I'm sorry. Communique. In February 1978, in which he informed the city that a serial killer was on the loose, that police finally linked Bright's murder to him. In the taunting letter he wrote, "You guessed the motive and the victim." By the winter of 1979, investigators had combed through every unsolved murder between 1974 and 1977 and finally concluded that several elements of Bright's killing bore a sick resemblance to those found in BTK's other known kills. By now, it was 3:45 in the afternoon. My legs were cramping up from sitting in this stuffy library for so long. I stood up from the hard wooden straight back chair I'd been camped out on for the past 3 hours and stretched my legs, hoping to clear my head before diving into my next batch of crime reports. Part of me wanted to take a break, needed to drag some fresh air into my lungs. But as soon as I stood up, I made the mistake of glancing at what lay on top of the pile. A grainy black and white photograph of Kathy Bright's bedroom. Unable to control myself, I grabbed the picture and sat back down. To hell with stretching my legs, I scolded myself. I'll take a break later. In my pocket was a pill bottle containing the blood-thinning medication that I'd come to rely on ever since emerging from my coma. I fished out 2 capsules and popped them in my mouth. The irony that I was attempting to catch one of the nation's most elusive serial killers while ingesting a blood-thinning drug that was essentially rat poison was not lost on me. I began dissecting the photograph, studying the mattress, which had been moved off the metal bed frame, the shoes scattered about the floor, and the comforter, blood smeared on the corner, that lay crumpled in the corner of the room. I'd learned long ago that the most important thing to remember when studying a crime photograph is to resist the urge for your eyes to be pulled into the center of the picture. Sometimes the thing you need to find most lies on the periphery of the photo at the distant edges. I was once called in to work a homicide where the victim had been raped. then stabbed 10 times in the throat. Local police believe that the unsub had stolen the victim's engagement ring after abducting her from a rest stop near Marlton, Arkansas, while she exercised her dogs during a cross-country car trip. The fact that her killer might be the type who collected souvenirs from his victims had spun the investigation into one dead end after another. The morning I met with the detectives in that Arkansas police station, the victim's parents were present in the room, desperate to find the man who had killed their daughter. The first thing I did was begin combing through the stack of photos snapped at the crime scene. By the time I reached the third photograph, I found myself pointing to a tiny gray object wedged between the carpet and the frame of the passenger door, situated on the far right side of the picture. "What's this?" I asked. The victim's aunt peered at the photo and gasped, "Oh my God, it's the ring!" This particular homicide had already been featured on America's Most Wanted, and the public had been advised that the killer had taken the victim's ring. That he hadn't told me the murderer wasn't the type who felt compelled to collect souvenirs or mementos from his victims. This meant that that detectives needed to track a killer with a different psychological makeup, which ultimately changed the course of their investigation. The killer was eventually linked through DNA to cases in California and Montana. Something told me not to expect this sort of lucky break in the BTK case. And as I stood there in that library, thumbing through the various photos snapped in the rented wooden house where Kathy Bright lived with her older sister, along with a few taken in the medical examiner's office, I saw only one thing: a vibrant, feisty young woman whose life was ripped away too soon. So I settled back into my chair at the table and began immersing myself in the sad, cold facts surrounding her murder. It was a couple minutes shy of 12:30 in the afternoon when the front door of the white clapboard house burst open and 19-year-old Kevin Bright flung himself outside, staggered through the ice-crusted snow, and began running down the street. Blood had soaked through his white t-shirt. The sight of this young man stumbling through the streets, waving his arms and screaming something about his sister needing help, caught the eye of a passing driver. He slammed on his brakes. The passenger jumped out, quickly pushed the frantic man into the front seat, then sprinted to a nearby automotive repair shop and told the owner to call the cops. A few minutes later, as the Good Samaritan drove the dazed, bloody young man to the emergency room, a Wichita police dispatcher put out a call over the radio. Officers to a robbery at residence 3217 East 13th Street North. Suspect still at scene, armed and dangerous. Patrolman Raymond Fletcher was driving through the neighborhood. He arrived at the house 3 minutes later, scrambled out of his cruiser, and slowly walked up the front steps with his .38 caliber service revolver drawn. The front door was open. "Police officer," he yelled. "Police officer." And when he poked his head inside, he immediately spotted 21-year-old Kathy Bright lying on her side in a puddle of blood in the wood-paneled front room. Oriental carpets hung on the wall, and beer bottles crowded a makeshift table fashioned out of a cable spool. A telephone lay beside her. "Help me," she whispered in a faint, raspy voice. I can't breathe." Fletcher knelt beside her, keeping his eyes peeled for the suspect he believed might be hiding in the house. A I'm going to get you to a doctor, he told her. You just got to stay calm. Can you do that? He radioed for an ambulance while kneeling on the floor beside Bright, who appeared to be fighting to keep her eyelids from closing. Her breathing grew shallower with each labored inhalation. Do you know who did this to you? Fletcher asked, stroking her head. The poor woman was in bad shape, he thought. She could barely make any sound come out of her throat, so she just shook her head back and forth. The last words she uttered were, "Help me." What Fletcher didn't know at the moment was that Bright had been stabbed 11 times in her torso and was bleeding from nearly every major organ of her body. Two of the knife wounds had sliced through a portion of her lung, causing her to slowly suffocate. Her larynx had been also crushed. Moments later, several more patrolmen and detectives arrived on the scene. The back two bedrooms of the house were in shambles. Smears of blood could be seen on the floor. From the looks of things, Kathy had been tied to a chair with a pair of nylons, but had somehow broken free and crawled out to the phone. Because this was in the days before 911, she dialed the operator, but her assailant had crushed her larynx, so she was unable to utter anything besides a horrible, raspy howl. Shell casings from an automatic pistol that will later be identified as a Woodsman Colt 22 were found in the other bedroom. A nearby bathroom door had a hole blasted in it. A 22 slug belonging to the same pistol was soon dug out from the bathroom wall. In the kitchen, the back door window had been shattered and the glass swept neatly into a pile. An ambulance took Kathy to Wesley Medical Center, the same hospital to which her brother had been whisked 20 minutes earlier. She died on the operating table 5 hours later. She lost so much blood, she never really had a chance, recalls a detective who worked the case. Not far from where Kelly died, her brother lay in a hospital bed. Kevin was skinny as a rail, but tough as boot leather. Despite being shot twice in the head, he was eager shortly after emerging. I had to read that sentence again. It seems to be written incorrectly. Despite being shot twice in the head, he was eager shortly after emerging from surgery to tell detectives everything he could remember. The men pulled up chairs beside his bed and asked him questions. Kevin had driven into Wichita from his parents' house in nearby Valley Center the previous night and crashed at the rental house where his two sisters, Kathy and Karen, lived. Earlier that morning, Kevin and Kathy had gone to a local bank to see about getting a loan to help 19-year-old Kevin fund an invention he wanted to turn into a business. Karen was off working the first shift at Coleman. It didn't take long for the loan officer to nix his request, so they returned to Kathy's house and had just walked through the front door when, as Kevin recalled, a dark-haired man with a slight pot belly, standing about 5 feet 10 inches tall, wearing a stocking cap, gloves, a white t-shirt, and a green parka, stood waiting for them in the living room. He was holding a pistol. "Stop," the man told him. "Hold it right there." The intruder announced that he was on the lam from police in California and trying to get to New York. "I need your car keys and $100, he said. Kathy told him to take a hike. The man forced the two in a back bedroom at gunpoint. In the middle of the room, he positioned a chair. On a nearby bed, he laid out various ligatures and bindings made out of rope and nylons he'd apparently found in the house. Kevin was ordered to tie his sister to a chair. Then the intruder instructed Kevin to lie on the floor, and he bound Kevin's arms and legs with a pair of jeans and stockings. He placed a pillow beneath Kevin's head, then told Kathy to walk to an adjoining bedroom, which she was somehow able to do despite being tied to a chair. The stranger darted out the room and disappeared into another part of the house. Kevin couldn't quite figure out what this guy, who was both forceful and almost gentle, really wanted with the two of them. Before long, he can hear him opening drawers and slamming doors. After a few minutes, the man appeared back in the bedroom, walked directly over to Kevin, and without a moment's hesitation, kneeled beside him and wrapped what was either a pair of nylons or a rope around his neck, then pulled it tight. The force yanked Kevin up off the floor. And when Kevin suddenly realized what the intruder intended to do to him, he began squirming and twisting his hands and arms back and forth. Within seconds, the wiry youth managed to wedge his hands loose from their bindings, and he jumped up onto his feet. In a flash, the man pulled out the pistol with which he'd been threatening the Brights minutes earlier and pointed it at Kevin's forehead. He pulled the trigger. None of Kathy's neighbors reported hearing the shot, which wasn't surprising. I'd lost count of the number of homicides I worked involving a firearm that neighbors never heard go off. The force of a slug hitting his skull and the sheer shock of being shot knocked Kevin backward, and he quickly crumpled onto the floor unconscious. And when he came to a few moments later, the man had disappeared into the bedroom with his sister, obviously satisfied that he had taken care of Kevin. "You shot my brother," Kathy was shouting. "You shot my brother." And Kevin sat up on the floor and listened as the stranger tried to calm her. "Relax," he said. "I only wounded him. He's gonna be okay." Kevin attempted to stagger to his feet, but the noise he made must have reached their attacker. The man walked back into the room where Kevin had just managed to untie his legs. In a flash, Kevin remembered seeing the grip of a pistol tucked into the waistband of the man's pants, lunged at him, grabbed the gun, and managed to shove it into the man's chest. He squeezed the trigger, but before the hammer could slam down on the back of a round in the chamber, the attacker wedged his fingers beneath the hammer, preventing the gun from discharging. The two wrestled for control of the pistol, and Kevin managed to squeeze the trigger one more time, but once again, the gun didn't fire. The man finally wrenched the weapon free, quickly took aim at Kevin's head and fired but missed. He pulled the trigger again and the bullet hit Kevin in the mouth, tearing through his upper lip, turning Kevin's face into an even bloodier mess than it already was. What the gunman didn't know, however, was that Kevin's front teeth deflected the slug. Kevin crumpled to the ground once again, and the gunman jumped on top of him in a flash, then wrapped a rope around his neck and yanked it tight. Upon hearing the pistol shots, Kathy began screaming, and the man ran back into the other bedroom where she was, still tied to a chair. Kevin blacked out for an unknown amount of time, probably just a few minutes. When he came to and stumbled to his feet, his sister was still screaming. He made a split-second decision that sent him running out the front door. The best thing he could do for Kathy, he decided, was to run and get help. 15 minutes later, a police cruiser pulled up in front of Bright's house. The detectives listened as Kevin whispered his story to them, amazed at his indestructibility and moved by his devotion to his older sister. Despite his injuries, he practically had to be tied down in the hospital bed to prevent him from fleeing the hospital and hitting the street to search for Kathy's killer. Before leaving his hospital room, one of the detectives opened up an identikit used by police to create composite sketches of an unknown suspect. Over the next 45 minutes, Kevin pored through the seemingly infinite number of combinations in the book and reconstructed what he could recall from his assailant's face. And he told the officers that the man was a stocky 25-year-old Caucasian with dark hair and a thick, dark mustache. He stood about 5'10", had a black stocking cap pulled over his head, which he later removed, and wore a uniform that consisted of an orange shirt and jacket. The completed picture was immediately put on the wire and distributed to law enforcement agency in the western states where it was believed that the assailant had come from. Despite the fact that police suddenly had what could be a good description of the Bright's attacker, the composite caused a fair bit of dissension among several of the detectives assigned to the case. A few believed that the likeness might actually help them nab Kathy's murderer, whereas others doubted that Kevin, who many suspected had suffered a concussion, could be expected to recall much of value about the suspect. In all my years working these sort of cases, I'd rarely heard of a witness involved in a violent crime being able to create a composite drawing that turned out to resemble the perpetrator. That's why detectives and prosecutors know that they had better have more than just eyewitness testimony to tie a suspect to a crime. Many an investigation has been sent down a dead-end road for this very reason. Nevertheless, in the absence of anything else to work with, the Wichita police quickly put out an all-points bulletin using the details Kevin provided along with the sketch he helped create. Other than the clothes and nylons that had been used to tie up the Brights, detectives found precious little evidence in the house. The only set of latent fingerprints that police were unable to identify was found on the back door, but these turned out to belong to Bright's landlord, and he was quickly eliminated as a suspect. Police knocked on every front door in the lower middle class neighborhood where the sisters lived, asking if anyone could remember seeing a suspicious-looking character shortly after the attack. But no one reported seeing anyone out of the ordinary. A bloody white nylon rope was discovered under a tarp in the bed of Kevin's rusted, decrepit Ford truck parked on Holyoke Street. Police surmised that the killer might have tossed them in there when fleeing the scene. About the only thing detectives had to work with was a small amount of marijuana they discovered in the house, leading them to wonder if maybe the attack had something to do with a drug deal gone awry. But then Karen Bright admitted that she and her sister were recreational pot smokers, something the cops had no problem believing because the amount found was so minuscule. Although police weren't ruling out the possibility that a local resident could be responsible for the brutal slaying and shooting, they reached out to California authorities, trying to determine if the description given by Kevin matched any fugitives they were currently pursuing. Before long, what few leads they had to work with had grown ice cold. Although there were a few whispers among detectives that Bright's killer might be the same individual responsible for the Otero murders. Nobody wasted much time trying to link the two cases. And why would they? There appeared to be so many differences. Bright's killer didn't cut the phone line, and he used both a knife and a gun on his victims. Even his knots, which had been tied from jeans and nylons as opposed to the Venetian blind cord used at the Otero crime scene, were different. Kathy had been tied with granny knots, whereas the Oteros had been bound with both clove hitches and half hitches. By the end of April, something else was clear. 1974 was turning out to be one of the most bloodiest in recent memory. 6 months after the discovery of those four bodies in the Otero house, another quadruple homicide rocked Wichita. Those murders, however, were quickly revealed to be the result of a drug ripoff. But the Otero and Bright murders were different. Every homicide detective knows that good, thorough victimology, which quite simply is a study of the victim of a particular offender, can help crack cases. The problem with the Otero and Bright murders was that all these victims were low risk, meaning that there was no single clue to indicate why they were destined to die a violent death. None had engaged in any personal or criminal activities that might explain the fate they met. They were all just regular people living and working in a community where the overall crime rate was remarkably low. The fact that none of the victims had probably ever laid eyes on their killer before he struck was another reason why police were having such a rough time unearthing any solid leads. Yet there were a few detectives in homicide who believed that the same killer might be responsible for all five murders. It wasn't until October 8 that police received what they cautiously believed might be the biggest break in the case. Gary Sebring, a local resident with a lengthy history of deviant behavior that included an arrest for having sex with a duck in Riverside Park, was picked up for molesting a 5-year-old girl behind a public library. While being questioned about the incident at the police station, Sebring made an off-the-cuff comment about the Otero homicides that proved to be the equivalent of dropping a lit match into a gas tank. He said, "If I was doing the Oteros, this is how I would have done it," recalls one officer who worked the case. "I would have been with my brother, and we would have tied them all up, and my buddy Thomas Myers would have been with us." Anyone looking at their individual rap sheets could tell that Gary Sebring and his brother Ernest had serious mental problems. So did Myers. If somebody was going to give false confessions to a quadruple homicide, they were the perfect candidates. But the heat to crack the Otero murders was getting intense, and because the three had a history of sex offenses, the decision was quickly made to bring them in for questioning. And although this was 5 years before I first got involved with the case, if I'd been working on it, I would have told the cops not to bother. From a profiling standpoint, the Otero's killer was far too sophisticated and careful to have a history of bestiality and attempted molestation of a juvenile on his rap sheet. It just didn't fit. Myers couldn't be found, but on October 9, Sebring's older brother was taken in and grilled. Instead of being booked in jail, the Sebrings were taken to a local mental hospital for evaluation. On October 18th, Myers was located after he tried committing suicide, and paramedics were called to the scene. Eventually, he was placed under observation in a psychiatric hospital. Despite Gary's rambling statement about his involvement in the murders, police quickly realized they opened a Pandora's box due to the threesome's mental instability. Years before, my behavioral science unit worked on a case with similar dynamics involving two homicides that had occurred nearly a decade apart in Northern Virginia. After reviewing the murders, we concluded that the same offender was responsible for both crimes. There was just one problem. A mentally challenged man was currently sitting in jail for the first homicide at the time the second murder had occurred. We eventually discovered that police interrogators had convinced the suspect to confess to the killing, telling him it was the only way to avoid the death penalty if convicted. The real killer, it turned out, was a career burglar who committed the murders during his probationary stints in halfway houses. He was later found guilty of the killings, and the governor exonerated the first man and ordered him released from prison. None of the three men in Wichita were ever charged with any crime, but media coverage of these new unnamed suspects in the Otero case evidently began to annoy the real killer. The fact that three posers were getting ink and airtime for what he considered to be the crowning achievement of his life proved more than he could bear. Later in the morning on October 22nd, he telephoned the Otero murder hotline set up by one of the city's two daily newspapers, the Wichita Eagle and Beacon. When columnist Don Granger picked up the phone, the voice at the other end of the line got right to the point. "Listen. And listen good, because I'm not going to repeat it," he growled, explaining that the man who killed the Oteros had stuck a letter inside a mechanical engineering textbook on the second floor of the Wichita Public Library. So these three mental patients are getting attention and are suspected of committing the Otero murders. And BTK gets pissed off because he doesn't want anybody to steal his shine. Ain't that about a bitch? So he leaves a letter inside a mechanical engineering textbook in the Wichita Public Library. It's getting good, y'all. It's getting good. That was all he said. Then he hung up as if really annoyed. Granger immediately telephoned Floyd Hannon, the chief of police, and told him the news. Within minutes, Detective Drowoski was combing through the aisles of the library, located across the street from police headquarters, searching for the book. He eventually found a white envelope with the name Bill Thomas Kilman, which police would eventually realize was an acronym for BTK, typed in the upper left-hand portion of the envelope. Jaworski's first impression upon reading it was, it was jumbled up to make everyone think he was an idiot, which he was, but it also became apparent that he had a certain sick intelligence to him. The letter had been typed and was laced with butchered syntax and numerous misspellings, grammatical mistakes, and misconjugated verbs. of the detectives who pored over it, no one was quite sure whether the errors were unintentional or added simply to fool police into believing they were dealing with an imbecile. It had been my experience that offenders who communicated with police generally attempted to disguise their writing and throw investigators off by purposely misspelling words or using improper grammar. But one thing was clear. Whoever created this one-page letter didn't seem concerned about sending police the original rather than a photocopy. He had to know that forensic specialists would comb through every square inch of the letter with a microscope. He had to know there was a good chance that it contained a crucial piece of physical evidence that might allow investigators to trace the letter back to him. It was also risky because it provided investigators with their first real glimpse into this cold, savage mind. Even if everything he wrote was a lie, from that point onward, he was no longer an invisible phantom. His image, albeit still terribly murky, had begun to take some semblance of shape and form, and he was okay with that. His ego obviously allowed him to believe the risk to be worth it. Here was what the letter said. Otero case, I write this letter to you for the sake of the taxpayer as well as your time. Those 2-3 dudes you have in custody are just talking to get publicity for the Otero murders. They know nothing at all. I did it by myself with no one's help. There has been no talk either. Let's put it straight. Joe, position, southwest bedroom, feet tied to the bed, head pointed in a southerly direction. Bondage, window blind cord, garrote, blind cord, brown belt, death, the old bag trick and strangulation with clothesline rope. Clothed, white sweatshirt, green pants. Comments. He threw up at one time. Had rib injury from wreck a few weeks before. Laying on coat. Julie. Position. Laying her back crosswise on the bed pointed in southwest direction. Face cover with a pillow. Bondage. Blind cord. Garrote. Clothesline. Cord tie. In a clove hitch. Death, strangulation twice. Clothes. Blue house coat, black slack, white sock. Comments. Blood on face from too much pressure on the neck. Bed unmade. Josephine. Position. Hanging by the neck in the northwest part of the basement. Dryer or freezer north of her body. Bondage. Hand tied with blind cord. Feet and lower knees, upper knees and waist with clothesline cord. All one length. Garrote. Rough hemp rope. 1/4 diameter noose with 4 or 5 turns. Clothes. Dark bra cut in the middle. Sock. For some reason, BTK left out the pale blue t-shirt and panties pulled down to her socks. Death. Strangulation once. Hung. Comments. Most of her clothes at the bottom of the stairs. Green pants and panties. Her glasses in the southwest bedroom. Joseph. Position. In the east bedroom, laying on his back, pointed in eastern direction. Bondage, blind cord, garrote, 3 hoods, white t-shirt, white plastic bag, another t-shirt, clothesline cord with clove hitch. Death, suffocation once, strangulation, suffocation with the old bag trick. Clothes, brown pants, yellow brown striped t-shirt. Comments. His radio is blaring. All victims had their hands tied behind their backs, gags of pillowcase material, slip knots on Joe and Joseph's neck to hold laid down or was at one time. Purse contents south of the table. Spilled drink in that area also, kids making lunches. Door shade and red chair in the living room. Otero's watch missing. I needed one, so I took it. Runs good. Thermostat turned down. Car was dirty inside, out of gas. I'm sorry this happened to society. They are the ones who suffer the most. It's hard to control myself. You probably call me psychotic with sexual perversion hang-up. When this monster enter my brain, I will never know. But it here to stay. How does one cure himself? If you ask for help that you have killed 4 people, they will laugh or hit the panic button and call the cops. I can't stop it, so the monster goes on and hurt me as well as society. Society can be thankful that there are ways for people like me to relieve myself at time by day. Dreams of some victims being tortured and being mine. It a big, complicated game, my friend, of the monster play, putting victims number down. Follow them, checking up on them, waiting in the dark, waiting. Waiting. The pressure is great. And sometimes he run the game to his liking. Maybe you can stop him. I can't. He has already chosen his next victim or victims. I don't know who they are yet. I don't know who they are yet. The next day after I read the paper, I will know, but it's too late. Good luck hunting. Yours truly, guiltily. P.S. Since sex criminals do not change their MO or by nature cannot do so, I will not change mine. The code words for me will be bind them, torture them, kill them, BTK. You see, he added again, they will be on the next victim.
Somebody will get a tambourine. Somebody had a washbowl. Somebody had a bass drum. Somebody had different kind of music. When they will get happy, they will look at the saints of God. Is it help me drive on? Drive on, take it away. Help me drive on.
Help me drive on.
There was no signature on the bottom of the letter. Instead, whoever penned it drew a cryptic symbol created from the letters BTK. Judging from the way he describes his crimes, with the attention to detail of a detective, whoever wrote the letter was clearly a wannabe cop. But he obviously needed to bone up on his criminology 101, because plenty of criminals do change their MOs. Decades later, investigators would learn that BTK changed his modus operandi when he removed the bodies of his last two victims from their house. What doesn't change is the killer's signature, which is something the offender does to fulfill himself emotionally, but that isn't necessarily needed to accomplish the crime. In the Otero murders, and we would later learn in the Bright case, BTK's signature was the use of bindings and gags along with a form of psychological torture wherein he denied his victims the courtesy of a quick death. Not surprisingly, detectives pounced on the letter almost as soon as it landed on Chief Hannon's desk and began picking it apart, examining it for hair, fiber, and fingerprints, then sifting through every single misspelling and word usage, looking for any clue they could unearth. The first thing that jumped off the page was the fact that whoever sent it had, when discussing the suspects being looked at by police, crossed out the word two and replaced it with three. He evidently had written the letter before October 18th, when Thomas Myers was finally located. But for some reason, he had opted to sit on his communique for several days before sending it. Clearly, the unsub didn't want someone else getting credit for what he considered to be his Mona Lisa. But there was another reason. He appeared to be enjoying how he was making the Wichita police resemble the Keystone Cops. The last thing he wanted was for his local law enforcement agency to garner any positive accolades from the media or the community for possibly solving the Otero murders. The unsub didn't claim responsibility for Bright's murder for the simple reason that he'd left behind a living witness, her brother. Police wouldn't make that connection until the waning months of 1979, but now that I learned he'd been responsible for Kathy's botched, bumbling, albeit lethal attack 4 months earlier, it seemed quite possible that he also typed his letter to police in order to remind himself and them of exactly what he was capable of when he was at the top of his game. After all, here was a killer who, in the Otero case, was able to overpower and con a family of four into submission. What was certain, however, was that his letter contained a level of detail that only the Otero's killer could have known. It went far beyond anything that appeared in the media after the homicides occurred. It read like a police crime report. His description was so exact that I was left wondering if he'd photographed the crime scene before fleeing. How could he remember all those details if he hadn't brought a camera, or perhaps discovered one at the house and used that? Yet for all the precise, accurate information he included in his letter, there was also something peculiar. A few of the descriptions were so off the mark that the detectives were a bit stumped. For instance, at the crime scene, Joseph didn't have a bag on his head, and Julie's face wasn't covered by a pillow. The reason, police eventually learned, was that the Otero children had removed them while trying to revive their parents. Also, BTK never mentioned the pale blue t-shirt that Josephine was still wearing after her death. In the end, however, these inaccuracies actually did more to prove that whoever penned the letter actually was the Otero's killer. After all, he would not have known that the crime scene had been disturbed. He would have expected it to look exactly the way it did when he fled the house. Another factual error was that the writer's claim that he used 5 turns of his rope to create Josephine's noose. In reality, he only used 3. Detectives wrote off this mistake as a case of inattention due to the excitement he must have been experiencing prior to killing his 11-year-old victim. Another perplexing aspect of the letter was the writer's reference to Josephine's glasses being left in the bedroom. Why would the killer have gone to the trouble of placing them there? Was it simply some weird way to taunt police? The answer turned out to be much more mundane, although decades would pass before investigators learned the real reason. Over the next couple of weeks, nearly 24 psychologists and psychiatrists were shown the contents of the letter and asked to compile a personality profile of the individual they believe might have written it. The doctors were divided over whether or not it should be released to the public, something police weren't hesitant to do out of fear that they'd be inundated by an avalanche of false leads they knew they didn't have the manpower to investigate. We now know that there was an issue far more important than whether or not the department needed additional personnel to chase down leads. My belief is that police might have been more effective in their efforts if they'd been more forthcoming with the release of information to the public. Because when provided with useful behavioral characteristics of an unsub, the community can begin acting as a powerful tool for investigators, serving as their eyes, ears, and a type of collective data bank. Surely somebody, somewhere, may have seen something around the time of the murders, some odd bit of behavior in a friend, coworker, or relative. But until people are given some clue as to what they're supposed to have seen, they can't help connect the dots for police. The specialists were unanimous in their assessment. The writer was a very sick man who had a fetish for bondage. His reaction sexually is to be bound, to bind other people, Chief Hannon eventually told reporters. At the request of police, Granger placed a classified ad in the newspaper, which ran from October 24th to October 27th, urging the killer to contact him. It read, BTK, help is available. Call 684-6321 before 10 p.m. Granger never received any response from the ad. A few days later, he wrote a column in the newspaper explaining that police were searching for a man who needs help badly, who had information about the Otero murders. The intrepid columnist went so far as to ask the man to call him at home, but the call never came. The killer was no longer in a talkative mood. He obviously had other things on his mind.
my children. I'd just like to tell you thank you for 20 wonderful years. Got slim sometime, but the Lord kept us. And for somebody tonight listening to me, wherever you are, when you hear this record, I don't know what you'll be going through. But there's somebody in here that can tell you when the low gets the worst. I wish I had some church folk here. When the night gets the darkest. That's God's good time. That's when he steps in. Sometime late in the midnight hour, when I finally crawled into bed after worrying with the cares and stripes of the day, and everybody in the house was asleep, and I just lay there sometime burdened, not knowing what's gonna happen, which way things are going, and I had to stop and ask God this question. What shall I do, Lord?
What steps should I take? What should I take? Oh, Lord, what shall I do?
Anybody ever had to ask him that? What shall I do?
What shall I do?
And the little young girl said to the man, he's not going to make it, is it? And you know, when you know what you know. I was hurting, but I heard her. And I raised up off that emergency tape and said, yes, I am. Because the Lord I serve. And this is what I told the man. I know he'll come through. Can I get a witness in here? See you no more. I want you to take this as serious as possible. If I don't ever see you no more, I want you to hold on to this one thought. No matter where you find yourself in life, just know that God's gonna come through. Together. I know he'll come through.
Oh Lord,
I wish I could get you to turn around, shake somebody's hand behind you, tell them, hang on in there. Because I know he'll come through.